Three Conservative MPs have shared a video which purported to show that Labour leader Keir Starmer had been dismissive of the victims of child sexual exploitation when he was Director of Public Prosecutions. So the MPs in question were Lucy Allen. So she's quote tweeting this tweet from N. James World. We'll look at the original tweet in a moment. She says, "This suggests a total failure to understand grooming, a dismissive attitude toward child sexual exploitation victims, and a belief that the victims brought it on themselves." So quote tweeting the same tweet, Maria Caulfield MP wrote, "The true face of Labour leader, hashtag shameful." And Nadine Dorris, who is a shadow health minister, quote tweeted the video saying, "Revealing." Now, at least those first two tweets, it seems like this is something very serious. Obviously, if he had been dismissive of victims of child sexual exploitation, that would be, you know, appalling. Let's look at the tweet they were sharing. So this is the video that all three of these Tory MPs shared.
"Were made included the assumption that a victim of child sexual abuse will swiftly report what's happened to them to the police, will be able to give a coherent and consistent account first time, that they will not themselves have engaged in any offending or other behaviour, and that they will not have misused drugs or alcohol at any stage."
So that video is presented as saying, this is why, or this is how Keir Starmer approached child sexual exploitation. So it's saying Keir Starmer would only accept a witness to child sexual abuse if they had swiftly reported the abuse, had given a consistent account from the first report, had not themselves broken the law or used drugs and alcohol. Now, that would be pretty shocking. And also, that is how the state has functioned. And it is incredibly shocking. But that video of Keir Starmer is completely misleading. And also, obviously so, I don't think the MPs really can claim ignorance in this moment. But let's look at the full clip now.
"Just how much of an acknowledgement is this that the methods you've been using up until now, albeit everyone's been working very hard, but the methods you've been using up until now just have been really in the wrong mindset and so misguided?"
"These guidelines are a recognition that the approach that's been taken in the past was the wrong approach. It was based on a number of assumptions which don't withstand scrutiny. The guidelines change that, and they require the police and prosecutors to focus intensely on the allegation actually being made, and not so much on the weaknesses or vulnerabilities that are invariably there in some of the victims that come forward."
Could you just expand a little on what you mean by the kind of things that were going wrong? Just give us some kind of obvious examples of how the previous guidelines weren't really up to standard.
"The assumptions that were made included the assumption that a victim of child sexual abuse will swiftly report what's happened to them to the police, will be able to give a coherent and consistent account first time, that they will not themselves have engaged in any offending or other behaviour, and that they will not have misused drugs or alcohol at any stage. Those assumptions do not withstand scrutiny. They've got to change. The guidelines make that clear. And so this is a clear break with the past."
So, I mean, it couldn't be clearer. Keir Starmer was saying, this is how it used to work, and this is precisely why we're changing our guidelines. And what these Tory MPs have shared is the bit where he says, this is how it used to work. And they're saying that's his justification for how he was operating in the CPS. So it's a complete reversal of what actually happened. And I mean, this Nadine Dorris, at least, she's a government minister. She's a health minister. She should have very important things to do at the moment without sharing nonsense fake news about the leader of the opposition.
Well, she should. But would you trust Nadine Dorris with very important things to do?
That's true. God, that's terrifying, isn't it, actually, that she is a health minister? I often think of her just as a sort of joke character, but that she does have a position of responsibility is absolutely terrifying.
So, recently had a clip go viral around far-right Twitter around the Yes Lads, We're Winning, right, where it was clipped out of context. And in the context, it would show you that I'm taking the piss out of the very view which is then being assigned to me when it's taken out of that context and sent around. Now, the reason why it's able to go so far is because it's being propped up by an existing ecosystem of hatred, bigotry, and far-right ideology. Anyone with the, you know, faintest semblance of media literacy would have even looked at that clip and gone, well, she's clearly being facetious, right? So she can't be seen to genuinely mean what she's saying because of her delivery. Now, if you look at Keir Starmer's, even the edited clip, it's very clear that he's saying these were the assumptions being made. So you have to be really willing, somebody, to embody the worst characteristics that you have already assigned to them in order for you to make that mistake. So it's not something which is born simply of ignorance. It's really building on something that's already there. And that's how these clips go viral. And what's worrying is that what had once been, you know, a at sometimes flimsy and other times robust firewall between the establishment parliamentary right and the extreme far right has completely been decimated, in part because of Brexit, but also because of, you know, Boris Johnson's willingness to shift his party in that direction, you know, speak to that cohort of Britain and you know, at best turn a blind eye and at worst encourage those views amongst his own MPs. And so you've got, you know, sort of clusters of MPs who've kind of always been flirting with a very strange kind of, you know, white nationalist conspiratorial resentment, who are ideal candidates to platform and signal boost this kind of, you know, falsified conspiracy theory regarding Keir Starmer. Now, what's really good is that Keir Starmer has enough pull with the media at this moment in time to be able to have, you know, those who are sympathetic towards him rebut this view. It's, you know, deleted by Nadine Dorries and so on and so forth, that no apology has been forthcoming yet. And it hasn't damaged him at the level of mainstream media just yet. But we're still very early into his leadership. And if we've got senior conservatives playing this dirty now, when we're still 4 years out officially from an election, and you've also got that kind of, WhatsApp fascist ecology of conspiracy theories and rumors already having a decent amount of traction, both on the internet and making their way onto the conservative, government benches, that's worrying.
Just going to go to a couple of past tweets from Nadine Dorries, because she does have
form.
I mean, she has form. Sorry, that's the phrase, isn't it? In terms of tweeting far-right accounts and being basically awful online. So let's get up this first one. I think it's from 2018, is it? Can we get out this tweet? So she says, ministers, are you having a laugh? And what she's doing is quoting there another far-right account. So this one of Keir Starmer was also a far-right account, saying Muslims can receive benefits for multiple wives. Yes, that's from the 17th of September, 2018. Obviously, you know, that's a Tommy Robinson supporting account. Anyone who's not a complete idiot can recognize that. So either she is a complete idiot and she shouldn't have a position of responsibility in the British government, or she is actively sharing far-right material.
What about both?
Potentially both. Yeah, I think those two do often go together, actually, don't they? There's a strong theory there, Ash. And our next tweet, our next piece of evidence. So here she is quote tweeting a video from Sadiq Khan back in 2018. So his, I think, video is about hate speech. And she says, how about it's time to act on sex abusing grooming gangs instead? Hashtag Telford grooming, hashtag Rotherham, hashtag priorities, hashtag leadership. Now, Sadiq Khan is mayor of London. He's from London. We know his dad was a bus driver. So what does he have with Telford grooming or the appalling grooming that was going on in Rotherham? What possible reason could she be quote tweeting Sadiq Khan to say that, other than that he is a high profile Muslim politician? No other explanation. That tweet hasn't even been deleted, by the way. So this is a health minister currently in government who has quite obviously abused the most high-profile Muslim politician in the country, and that's seen as completely acceptable. Appalling. The political response to these tweets, there's also an issue here. I thought, in terms of when this was first shared, this could be a good opportunity for Keir Starmer to clear the air, because we know that these videos are going to be going viral during this period, especially on WhatsApp groups, potentially a bit underground. You know, people will see that clip, and, you know, without any context, they might think, oh, that is pretty bad. Maybe Keir Starmer doesn't care about grooming. Maybe he's someone who really dismisses girls who've been sexually abused. And I thought, because it's been a you know, he can maybe take Nadine Dorries to court. He can get her to apologize publicly, get a bit of profile on it. And so that will mean that it will have been a story that is publicly debunked. But he didn't go for that. I suppose I'll ask you, Aaron, if you think that was a missed opportunity on his part. So let's get up this graphic, which was what the Downing Street spokesman said. So this was the response to Nadine Dorries from the Conservative Party. These tweets have rightly been deleted. The MPs involved have been spoken to by the Whip's office and reminded of their responsibility to check the validity of information before they post on social media sites. Now, that could not be a weaker reprimand. Check the validity of information before they post on social media. Now, that's like, that, you know, that seems like they've posted that, oh, sorry, the local, I'm a constituency MP and the local news agent is, there's been an accident there, blah, 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 blah. Not sharing some far right video, which is obviously doctored, which is smearing the leader of the opposition in the middle of a national crisis. That's ridiculous. But then this is Labour's response. This is also from that BBC article. So Keir said he was satisfied with the actions taken by the party and the MPs who have deleted the tweets. There are more important things in the world to concentrate on than a doctored video of me, he added. Now, I mean, from my perspective, obviously there are more important things in the world to concentrate on than a doctored video of Keir Starmer. But also, I mean, there are plenty of libel lawyers in the world who aren't currently working on coronavirus. So whilst, yes, Keir Starmer should be focused on coronavirus, there's nothing wrong with outsourcing that particular job to clear the air on this and to make sure that Nadine Dorries has to face more consequences than getting this most minor slap on the wrist that says you have to check the validity of information before tweeting a far-right account.
I mean, come on, Sir Keir. Ring, ring. Pondicata Ruck.
I thought he was a prosecutor. Aaron, what do you think about this?
No, I agree with you. I think they should have made an example of a, you need to create what, you know, what we'd call an electric fence. So just do not share ridiculous things about Keir Starmer, because you know what happened to Nadine Dorries. She ended up in court and she had to publicly apologise. But alas, no. But I agree with you from the perspective of political strategy. I think it's an inastute thing to just ignore. It won't go away. It will keep on happening. Keir Starmer's bet is that he'll be sufficiently Teflon to deal with it. I mean, I think that's partially true. I mean, what's interesting is you watch that video and you go, wow, this guy is a knight of the realm. He's the former head of the DPP. And he comes across so measured and so dull, right? Which is what you want in a DPP. You want a sort of quite a straight down the line procedural bureaucrat, effectively. You're administering a really important part of the state.
You don't want Jeff Goldblum, is what you're trying to say.
But even this guy, who couldn't be more dour, you know, these lunatics like Nadine Dorries have to present as kind of this unhinged leftist. Like, he's happy with grooming. He's like, This person, his personality, couldn't be, and I have political misgivings about Keir Starmer in a range of areas. He couldn't be further away from what you're trying to present him as. So I think, and this is going to be a real corrective to a lot of people. You saw James O'Brien saying, oh, they're attacking him because he really dismantled Boris Johnson at PMQs. No, they will do this to any Labour leader. Ed Miliband, Gordon Brown. People forget they did it with Tony Blair. At the beginning of Tony Blair's leadership of the Labour Party, his son went to the Oratory School. It's a grant-maintained school. It's not a public school in London. And the right-wing media tried to tear him apart. And he was actually really personally hurt by the whole thing. Sherry Blair, far more so. They will try, and John Major was just so bad, ultimately, and Blair was actually pretty good. It didn't really wash. But they're going to try this again and again and again with Keir Starmer. And like I say, his bet is he can push back on it. But we have to remember, Tony Blair, in the mid-90s, was a very different technological era. And like you say, we don't know the extent to which this goes through WhatsApp and back channels and so on. Those aren't public-facing media. And so I think you're absolutely right. He should have made an example of her.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose the difference here is that if this was Jeremy Corbyn, then you would have had some Labour backbenchers tweet it, and then it would have become a news story because no one in the mainstream media would have had any interest in debunking it. Whereas because it's Keir Starmer and they think he's a respectable politician, they will rally around him in a way that they never did with the previous leader of the Labour Party, who had, you know, smeary videos tweeted about him all the time, and they would always become a big news story because it would be Labour backbenchers that would force it onto the front pages because people say, well, if Labour MPs think it's serious, then it must be serious.
But also, don't forget, right, Corbyn's chances in 2017 after 2 years of being traduced in the media, and Corbyn's chances in 2019 after 4 years of being traduced in the media, were two very different things. 2017, he nearly becomes prime minister. 2019, it is electoral decimation. So in terms of how Keir Starmer should play this, it's, does he want to intervene when there is perhaps less leniency for him in the media, when perhaps for whatever reason there could be more, you know, factional infighting in the Labour Party, or much more, you know, aggressive styles of interrogation at PMQs, you know, or does he want that kind of, you know, underground far right media ecology to have reached a tipping point before he intervenes? I'm of the view of nip it in the bud, make an example of Nadine Dorries, and it means you can tackle these things absolutely head on, and you do it at a time when you have the most media support that you will probably ever have as leader of the opposition, even from, you know, newspapers like The Telegraph. You know, you can't bank on that 2, 3, 4 years down the line. And for Labour leaders who have, you know, held on to the leadership for the bulk of a full parliamentary term, it's been pretty bleak when it comes to recent elections. So for me, it's a matter of strategy. It's not a matter of Keir Starmer's politics. And I understand that he wants to come across as rising above the fray, as statesmanlike, you know, with a sense of perspective. But I think that this could grow very ugly. I think that it will grow very ugly. And I think that he has to crack down as hard as he can, as soon as he can.